So, let's talk about classical chaos. The butterfly effect is a film. In that film, the main character wants to change something of his present. How many times we thought about this? If I could go back in time, right? Because if you're in a film, you can't go back in time. So the main character tries to go back in time to change things in the past that could affect the future. And indeed, this is a very good way to explain what is indeed the butterfly effect in mathematics, which is the idea of chaos. Indeed, Edward Lorentz in 1972 gave a talk with title, "Does the Flap of a Butterfly Wing in Brazil Set Off a Tornado in Texas?" This looks like the title of a film, but it's the title of a talk. And indeed, there have been films, books about this idea of chaos. And the idea of chaos is precisely the idea that if you can go back in time and change the initial conditions slightly, just a little, tiny little bit, then in the future, the change can be enormous. And that's the idea of chaos. And I'm going to put a simulation here. I want to thank Robert Dreist for this simulation. Here we have this is a particle that is following a path, and this path can be the solution of is a solution of a differential equation corresponding to some physical problem. Okay. And indeed, I'm putting three different initial conditions that at the beginning, let me put this again, at the beginning, they are very close. So here there are three balls, we don't see them.
Right. They're visually indistinguishable.
They are indistinguishable. But as the time goes on, these three balls, you see now we start to see it looks like a big ball. Okay, now we see two balls. Well, with my glasses, I would see better, but I took them out because people talk about the purple eyes, and this is a bit scary. So now we have the three balls going away and away, and you see the trajectories of these three balls. They are very far away. So think of these trajectories of these three balls as the life of the main character of this butterfly effect. You want to change something in the past. It's enough to change maybe slightly, slightly one tiny decision that you took. And in the future, the difference is big. Hmm. And that's the idea of chaos. And indeed, the idea of chaos, chaos theory was discovered in a way by chance. And it was discovered, well, it's attributed to Edward Lorentz, but in the group of Edward Lorentz, there was Ellen Vetter and Margaret Hamilton. We know Margaret Hamilton because she did all the software engineering that took us to the moon, right, in the Apollo missions. But before that, she was in the team of computations of Edward Lorentz, and they were making some studies in meteorology, okay? And then they were finding that some data didn't make sense, okay? And it's not that they didn't make sense. It's that if we change some initial conditions slightly, long term, the changes are big, okay? And this goes very well with the idea of weather. I mean, we cannot predict the weather in any accurate way more than 7 days, well, you can say 10 days, 15 days, not very, very precisely. And the problem of prediction of weather is related to these equations of Lorentz, indeed. So when you ask, what is the weather going to be? That's a difficult question. Right? So let's keep in mind this definition that Edward Lorentz gave of chaos. When the present determines the future, but the approximate present, so changing slightly the initial conditions, does not approximately determine the future. So if you change the conditions just a little bit, the outcome can be very different. So that's the idea. So that's the idea of unpredictable in the sense that we don't have enough capacity to measure the initial conditions of the particle. And that's the idea of chaos. That's the idea of classical chaos. So now let me talk about something real that we were living some months ago. We were living this, indeed, in December last year. We were told, or maybe in January, around December or January, we were told that there was going to be an asteroid falling on us, which was the Y4R asteroid. Okay. And we were all very worried until some scientists came out with this map. And then we were thinking, oh, are we away from this danger zone, right? Indeed, there was a moment when, well, we've seen films. Armageddon is based on this idea that an asteroid falls on us and it's not very pleasant. And we've seen here we have a simulation of the danger of this asteroid to fall on us. And as you can see, this is evolving. In January, it was 1.1. In February, it was getting high, 3.1 on February 19. Okay. I remember on February 19, I was indeed attending a program on TV and they were asking me about that. People were scared. So the probability was very high and then it went down. So now nobody is talking about these asteroids. On the other hand, you know, the odds of dying of an asteroid against other causes, well, here we have a summary. I mean, the odds of dying of an asteroid impact is very low. It's easier to fall from a certain height or to get shocked by eating or having a bicycle accident, right? So the question is, can we relax? Now we know that this asteroid is not going to fall on us. Immediately, this was happening in May, we heard about a satellite that was to crash on Earth. And then everybody was very worried. If you were reading Wales online, it said it could hit Wales or London or Catalonia or. Everybody was very nervous. I remember I had that week I had to give a talk and I was thinking, where is it going to fall? Well, most likely it's going to fall on water. And this is what happened. Okay, it crashed back on Earth overnight on water. Everything went fine. So indeed, how is the idea of chaos connected to the asteroids? It's closely connected because all the measures that we do of a certain satellite or asteroid depend on initial conditions. And the idea of chaos is present. Indeed, there is a whole theory called KAM theory, which is mathematical theory that controls, that allows us to give some probability that things are going to be all right somehow. So going back to your question, unpredictable can be, the answer is, well, something can be unpredictable for two reasons. One, because you don't have enough information about the initial conditions. And then after a certain time, this because of chaos, things can diverge completely. Or maybe you knock a door and there is no answer. Okay, it's because we cannot provide an answer because there is a logical barrier to a yes or no answer. Mm-hmm. And this puts us very nervous, right? Because we want to control the world, right? We human beings want to control the world and we as scientists want to understand everything. But there are frontiers that you just cannot cross. And that's exactly the idea of undecidable events. Now I'm going to provide some examples that a little bit go in this idea, right? We've seen that fluids like water or lava often rebel against what's expected, right? We've seen this with tsunamis. We've seen this recently. I mean, nature is revealing, right? It's rebelling against what's expecting. And the question is, well, can we use this kind of power of nature to compute? Indeed, that's a question that looks very wild, but it's a question that we could say it was already formulated by Roger Penrose. Roger Penrose was asking, what are the limits of computation? Can physical systems compute? This is already present in his famous book, on the Emperor's New Mind, okay? And here we have Chris Moore in the middle who really precisely asked this question. He asked, are fluids complicated enough to perform computations? And he asked this in a very particular context. And this was in the 90s. And then very recently, here we have Terence Tao. Terence Tao, one of the most famous mathematicians, or I would say the most famous mathematicians of the world nowadays, who is professor at UCLA. And he asked again this question. And his motivation was a different one. His motivation was, can I use this computational power to answer one of the unknown questions? Because we mathematicians, sometimes we cannot answer because we don't know how to do the things. That's true. I mean, it's like there are problems that we cannot solve and we don't know if they cannot be solved or not. It's not a question of undecidable. It's that we don't have still the mathematical power to solve them. And one of them is the Navier-Stokes riddle. Navier-Stokes equations have been used forever to model the movement of fluids, okay? And they are used all the time. We use them. We use them. Engineers use them. But we mathematicians, attention, we don't know if these equations have solution. What? How is this possible? We know that these equations have solution short term. These equations are more complicated than differential equations. They are partial differential equations. And we know they have solutions short term, but not long term. So these are equations we are actually using to model the movement of fluids, and we don't know if they have solution long-term. So there is an open problem, and I'll discuss about this problem in some minutes. I will give more details. And there is an open problem if whether these equations have solution or not. And while the community was somehow divided, but now it's more or less clear that these equations may have some kind of disruptive behavior that we called a blow up.
If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.